winter time can often be a time where a lot of people hang their rods up, wait for spring. Conditions can be grim, there can be dank, horrible days, but if you're anything like me, I always need a bit of an angling fix. And for me, winter time is synonymous with one species and one species only. I do love my winter carp fishing, but pike definitely resonate when I think of winter. I don't really know why, whether it's something to do with the style of angling, whether it's something to do with maybe like my childhood, but pike, when it comes to winter time, if I close my eyes and think of a cold, crisp winter's day, a dead bait float sailing away. They populate everywhere from canals to still waters, like here today I'm at Barnstone, to big pits. So there's a venue near everybody where pike will inhabit, and it's just a case of getting out there, regardless of the conditions, with your kit, make sure you set up for it, which we'll talk about later, and go and explore. And it is that sort of primeval link as an angler, where you've not got all the buzzers, buzz bars, rigs, you're not sitting there for long periods of time like you might do carp fishing, and your bite time's 2 a.m. and you're gonna sit a few hours before that. It's you versus beast. You are literally on your own against the fish. There's plenty of options for you to move around and explore. And there's a real element of freedom in that type of fishing. I think sometimes with anything in life, it's really nice to just strip away all the clutter and just go back to basics. And I think for me, this style of angling takes me back very fondly to when I was sort of teenage years, fishing the likes of Frisby Lakes, Saddington Reservoir, where there's big expanses of water. It's you versus these predators, and you go out and search and catch the fish of your dreams. And those fish have such an impact, I think. So much so that to this very day, as I've said before, I always prioritise being able to get out and do a bit of pike fishing.
The beauty of pike fishing, this is. Sat here calm, peaceful as you like, no action, staring at the float, and off it's gone. These waters, you never know what pike are in here, what size, or what could be your next bite. And that is the beauty. Rather than sitting on the sofa on a winter's day, get your pike gear, get down for a short day session. You never know what could turn up. Yeah, he's a nice double. You have it, a mint double. On a miserable day, I'm a very happy angler. I could be sat indoors, but for me, this is what winter fishing's all about. Monopolizing your time, traveling light, locating some pristine predators like this one. Something prehistoric, isn't there, about them? They are awesome fish. Me, and every winter I make sure that my diary has a little bit of time lotted out for my own fishing where I go in search of pike. Now, I said before about influences for me and pike and where that whole love affair for pike comes from. I don't know if it's the epic work of John Wilson and Go Fishing and those iconic videos of him on the Norfolk Broads with a drifter float sliding away, or whether it's Jaws. And the fact that I was absolutely obsessed by that film, and Jaws, essentially, in these freshwater environments, the apex predator is the pike. Brilliant, you get to cover loads of water, but we've had loads of rain. The water level's risen, and with that, a load of cold water's gone in. So generally, dead baits have performed better, purely because that bait's on the bottom. Pike can move nice and slow, come in, but lure fishing, the water's a bit warmer, or on certain days they do like chasing a lure, they're active. I persisted with one lure, had absolutely no success at all, and then switched to a white and red lure, mainly because I've been catching on dead bait smelts, which are quite white, and the bottom here, having carp fished here before, is very dark, black and silty, and I think that white contrasts against that really well. And as soon as I put that lure on, changed to that white one, first cast, smack, straight away. Unfortunately, I lost it. that's a snag. We've got a big one, big fish on. But that is an example, despite the slight embarrassment, of why you use really strong gear. Because there, what I've done is I've pulled into a snag, managed to bend the hook out on the lure and get everything back. What you don't want to do if you're pike fishing at any point is leave any sort of trebles, lures, anything out there. So use overly strong gear. That way you can bend the hooks out on snags and you're not going to leave any tackle out there that could potentially mean that pike gets entangled in it, takes it, and then is stuck with that in them forever. So you do not want that. Strong gear, get it all back, regardless of if you're snagged up like I got snagged up, and you're nice and safe. So is Mr. Pike.
When you actually get a pike as well, that feeling of a result on a winter's day, it could be a big pike, it could even be a jack, but those results and those feelings are amplified. Again, I don't know if it's just the intensity of the day's fishing, battling against the elements, but there's definitely a real buzz when you do get a result in winter. Not that there isn't in summer, but there is that extra edge in winter when there's inclement and you've battled against the conditions and you've worked for it.
Just making sure pike still there, basically. You can sort of tighten down to it and get a gauge on if they've got the dead bait or not. And if you're in any doubt, it's a case of reeling down and hitting him. He's definitely got it, I think. Check the drag. Yep, that is exactly why you need strong gear. Fish ran in to either a weed bed or some underwater structure, and I've managed to just coax him out of it. He feels like a good fish, to be fair. Now, in terms of handling and hooking pike, they are a fearsome predator, but they also are very delicate. Most important thing is you get a good grip on them. And in terms of a grip, I'm right-handed. So I'm gonna grip the fish with my left hand so that my right hand can do the unhooking and use all the tools. And you need all the tools and everything prepped before you get the fish out. The fish is on the mat. All I'm gonna do is have the fish with its back to me. I'm gonna slide my left hand under, and there's a little pocket under its jaw. I'm not near the gill rakers. I've got two fingers in there and a thumb. That allows me to pull its chin back, open the mouth to unhook it. That also is the point at which I hold it from and then support its weight underneath. A real tight grip's needed there in that little pocket with your fingers. Keep a good hold of it. If it thrashes around, by all means, lower it to the mat, but nice and confident with it. There's no injury that's going to be sustained or anything. Just be nice and confident. Once it's done and unhooked, get your photos nice and quick, pop it back in, and please use a sling or something. If you've got like a sling like mine, a floating retainer or a normal sling, to release the fish. And when you release it, make sure it's nicely recovered. Oh, and there's another bite. Luckily, I've got Dale on hand to secure that fish that's on the mat, and I'll release that later. I think he's put it just in the sling for a minute in the edge, because I put the old alarm on, the old float rod, just as I was doing that piece, just in case. And sure enough, classically, it's gone off and we've got another one. Short spell of action, classic of sort of piking at this time of year. It can all happen very quickly in a short period of time. And there's two bites. It's the one that interrupted my little talk about handling them. Nice long, lean one. I'm sure at the right time of year, he'll bulk out, probably get a few more roach down him. But that is a flurry of action, which it can often be wintertime piking. I'm very happy with. I'm gonna slip this one back. Make sure the other one's gone back as well, though Dale's lovingly secured him in the edge there. And then get those floats back out. I do love my winter piking.
Now I'm going to talk you through a real simple float fishing rig. It's the rig I've used for absolute years. The most important thing, it's easy to tie, it's reliable, and it's strong. You're not going to have to worry about pike safety or anything. Really simply, from the trace end, you can buy these in Tackle Shores. It's two size 4 trebles on a wire trace. I've got a couple of nice jazzy red bait flags on the end, but you don't have to have them. They're semi-barbed or barbless, depending on the rules of the venue. From that trace, I then have this sort of snap swivel arrangement. All that's there for is you can interchange your traces quickly. You can clip them on and off. If your trace gets kinked or if your hooks are blunt, you can put a new trace on easily. You don't have to retie the whole thing. From that, I've got two beads, nice big bore beads. They protect the knot, and then that snap swivel or clip that I was explaining to you before is knotted onto your main line. And my main line in this case is 60-pound braid. It's got to be strong. You might need to pull out snags. You do not want to leave any traces out there. I've then got a run ring that runs resistance free on the line to those beads that I had before. To that, I clip on a minimum of a 2-ounce lead. If you've got too light a lead, what can happen is the pike can pick up your dead bait, and that lead will provide resistance. They'll lift the lead, and when they feel that resistance, they'll drop the bait. You don't want that. You want it as resistance-free as a setup as possible. From the lead, you then got the main line that goes to a cigar style float, inline straight through it. I like these floats because they've got a contrasting black body and high vis top. And then I set the depth, the tiny little bead, in a float stop. And I like to fish it around about 2 to 3 foot over depth. The float will sit sort of semi-cocked on the surface. You'll get a couple of dips, and then it will slide away and you're into a pike. It's simple, effective and strong, easy to set up, provide you loads of hours of roving around, and hopefully you can get it on your own, get out there and watch this float slide away. Fact that pike are such voracious hunters, when you get them in your hands, they are just prehistoric in their makeup. You've got etchings on them, different markings, they're all so individual. And let's face it, they are tooled up, straight out killers. Serious teeth, serious gnashers. And you can go from working a lure very sedately, sort of going about your day, daydreaming, enjoying nature, to just a massive surge of adrenaline when something smashes your lure out of the edge. They are a fantastic species, and I think quite a lot of the time underrated. I know full well I've been on carp fisheries in the summer, seen pike in the edge and been like, oh yeah, whatever. But come winter time, those targets are there. Also, there is the factor of it's unknown. A lot of these fisheries, they sort of know what stock of carp are in there. Most of the A-team have got names and they're at a certain weight. But when it comes to pike, no one really knows. Might do a 21 week that you've never even heard of before. The stock of fish is sort of unknown. So every time that float goes down, you get a hit on your lure or that drop-off indicator drops away, you genuinely don't know. It could be 2 pounds, it could be 22 pounds, it could be even bigger. Whenever I go pike fishing, whatever venue I go on, I love lure fishing for a number of different reasons. First of all, often if I've just got a lure rod, a net, a mat, and some unhooking equipment, you can roam for absolutely miles. You're not tied down with any kit anywhere, and it's really ultra mobile. Secondly, a really good tactic, especially if you don't know the venue or you don't know where the pike might be held up, is to cast lures around strategically in different areas. Keep moving, and eventually if you get a few strikes or you catch one, then you can hone your dead bait rods into that area. It really does help you cover water quicker and work out where the pike are located. For instance, here on Barnstone, I've never pike fished here, so I'm going to go round some swims, flick a few lures about. If I think that there's some pike resident, I might then put the dead bait rods out. Invariably, lures catch everything, jacks as well as biggins. Generally though, jacks do like chasing a lure, so it can really help you in terms of location. Can also get you a few bonus pike on the bank. But whether you're doing it on its own or whether you're using it to sort of locate them, it's a brilliant tactic, really enjoyable. And let's face it, we all love a lure, don't we? I've got far too many in my tackle box, but they are great fun. Now, we've had plenty of pike, albeit a fair few smaller ones. So, you know what they say, big bait, big fish. I'd weigh that in. That is proper. I've got a big old herring, some size 4 trebles, a slightly bigger trace, and what I'm going to do is put the rod just to the left, sort of away from where we seem to be getting all the runs from these smaller ones, and hopefully with a bigger bait and slightly further away from where all the action's happening, we can tempt a real big one. Because let's face it, the exciting thing about these waters is you never really know how big they go until you've caught them. Here's to a 20. Oh, bite. Mark, she's up. She's going. It's a big bait, so I'm gonna give that time. Here she goes. No. Oh, look at the mess it's made of that dead bait. Yet another smaller one, but this one's a bit fuller. He's definitely been feeding. There's a few leeches on him, so he might have been lying up as well, but he's definitely got a good stomach full. They're beautiful fish. All of them are immaculate here. They're really clean. It's just mega to get about a bit of sport. It's been busy, really active. Thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm gonna slip this one back, keep going, and hopefully, if we play the numbers game long enough, who knows, maybe something special will turn up. I've caught a lot of, I'm very fortunate to have caught a lot of carp, and a 20 pound carp is still a massive fish, but a 20 pound pike, there's something about it. It's just a massive fish to have in your hands. They're an incredible beast, but at that size, they really are something else. And regardless of however many I'm fortunate enough to catch, hopefully in future years, I think always that 20 pounder will be a benchmark and always appeal as an absolute massive fish. I really, really love fishing for them in the winter. I can't express enough. I think another factor as to why I get on with them and love pike fishing so much is because normally the banks are quite scarcely populated. With pike fishing, you don't need loads of gear. You don't need to barrow down a barrow full, have a heater, have loads of food on the go. You can travel down with minimal gear, be very comfortable, and rove like I've done pretty much here, float. So you can have two floats, 20 minutes, half an hour. If you haven't had anything, move to another swim. You cover a lot of water. The great way, I think, of instead of doing absolutely nothing in winter and being a bit pent up, let's face it, we know what Christmas is like. You sat there often for long periods of time wishing you were out. It's a great way of just a few hours, minimal tackle, a couple of rods, a net, an unhooking mat, and off you go. Could catch an unknown monster. You could get a few bites, but you scratch that itch, if you like, for some fishing, but also there is the prospect of catching something really, really magical. If you haven't tried it, get out there and try it. There's so many different venues. There's loads on the catch app. There's loads out there, probably local to you, where you can go and access them through the winter months, catch some brilliant fish, enjoy some brilliant sport, and another dimension of your angling. I can't speak highly enough about pike fishing and about pike as a species.